Okay. Thank you, everybody, for coming this evening. Honourable and rightful members of Parliament, Mr. Government Spokesman, Your Excellency Ambassador Vrividis, Honourable Mayors of the occupied towns of Lefkonigon and Aganthou, dear friends and colleagues. Welcome to this evening's Cyprus meeting and reception. It is a pleasure to see so many members of our community and members of Parliament who've taken time out from their busy schedules to be here. On behalf of the community, I'd like to extend our congratulations to the Prime Minister on her return to Downing Street and express our collective joy at the re-election of all our parliamentary friends. Indeed, congratulations should also go to Sir Roger, who was recently re-elected chairman of the APPG, and I mean kind of 10 minutes ago, and all the other... and all the other officers of the group, so the vice-chairs, Teresa, Bambos and Joan, the treasurer, Roger Godsiff, the secretary, Catherine West, and trustees, Kay Osamore, Baroness Massey, and Angus McNeil. I would also like to pay tribute to some of our parliamentary friends who did not return to the House, in particular Sir Alan Meal and David Burrows. Both of whom were long-standing supporters of human rights and social justice, advocating for the Cyprus cause and serving this House and their constituents with distinction. Despite the best efforts and concessions of President Anastasiadis in Crans Montana, the negotiations did not result in the much hoped-for solution that would have benefited all Cypriots. Today, on the 43rd anniversary of the illegal Turkish invasion and military occupation of the northern part of Cyprus, the issue remains unresolved, and we, as British citizens, are gathered here in our Parliament, pledging our unwavering commitment to ensure that our island is finally reunited. What we're asking for is both simple and fair, a solution based on the relevant UN Security Council resolutions and high-level agreements of 77 and 79, a fully functioning state that is in line with the rule of law and is free from foreign interference. Put simply, a normal state, as the UN Secretary General recently said, and a position that we are grateful to many of our parliamentary friends for supporting in the recent general election. At this point, I would also like to express our community's gratitude to the Prime Minister, the Foreign Secretary, and the Minister of State, and the entire team at the SCO for their active involvement in the latest round of negotiations. We live in challenging times. Through a period of regional civil unrest and instability, Cyprus has remained a beacon of hope, stability, and prosperity in the Middle East. Cyprus has signed energy agreements with international conglomerates for the exploration and exploitation of hydrocarbons, weathered the global financial crisis, and continues to attract business and investment. And in a period of unrest and constitutional review in Turkey, where the civil liberties and freedoms of thousands are placed into question, Cyprus continues to be a welcome destination and is home to more than 60,000 British residents. The United Kingdom and Cyprus have built a relationship of trust and mutual support over successive governments. And whilst the recent round of negotiations did not yield the desired outcome, we appreciate the UK's continued commitment towards a solution. At this point in time, the government and Prime Minister have a renewed opportunity to leverage the strategic and evolving relationship, in light of Brexit, that the UK has with Turkey to press for the removal of Turkish troops from the island, the abolition of the anachronistic system of guarantees, and safeguarding the stability of a strategic UK partner in the Eastern Mediterranean. As we saw from Crans Montana, despite President Anastasiadis' compromise proposals on the areas of governance, territory, and property, Turkey was not willing to make any concessions on the critical issue of security and guarantees. As members of Parliament in one of the most powerful and influential nations in the world, your position enables you to make a real and lasting change to the lives not only of your constituents and the 300,000 Britons of Cypriot origin, but the fate of an entire population asking for peace, justice, and restoration of their human rights. In the face of an increasingly intransigent Turkey, now is the time for all Cypriots, whether they're Greek Cypriot, Turkish Cypriot, Maronite, Latin, or Armenian, to ensure that our demands for a truly independent and sovereign Republic of Cyprus are heard loud and clear. Thank you very much for your time. We are expecting MPs to come in and out over the course of the evening, but I would, before the government spokesman speaks, I'd like to ask the recently re-elected chair of the APPG to say a few words.
Thank you very much indeed, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honour to be here, both as the newly elected or re-elected chairman of the All-Party Group, and also as a citizen of Morfu, an honour that I regard very highly indeed, and I don't take it for granted. It was... I ought to start, I suppose, with an apology. I have two other meetings that I have to chair in the course of this evening, so I'm going to have to love you and leave you, but love you I do. It was a bitter disappointment to us, your friends, in the House of Commons, in the Houses of Parliament, as it was to you, that the talks, for the moment at least, have collapsed. There was real hope that Niko Anastasiades and Mustafa Akinji would strike a deal, and I think, in fact, I'm certain that if they'd been left to their own devices, they would have done so. But unfortunately, as we all know, there are other influences that are brought to bear, and for the moment at least, those talks are on ice. You will hear later that there is a hope that they may be resumed once other European elections have taken place. But in the meantime, we do believe that there are other issues that we can pursue. All too often, the All-Party Group for Cyprus particularly has dealt almost exclusively with the Cyprus problem. And my dear friend, the late Robin Corbett, Lord Corbett, used to say he looked forward to the day when we could refer to Cyprus without referring to the problem in the same breath. Well, there are other issues that bind us all. Cyprus, a member of the Commonwealth, clearly has a role to play as we move forward with Brexit. And I'd like to reassure you all that your friends here in this House want to maintain the very strongest possible of ties, both with the expat Cypriot community and with the community on the island. And we will make every effort to make sure that that remains the case. So, disappointment, yes, but we move forward still with optimism. We, your friends in this House, and it's a cross-party friendship, remain as resolved as we have ever been to do everything in our power to see the day when you do have a united island, when the freedoms are recognised and when you can move freely through north and south and between Britain and the whole of the island of Cyprus as you ought to be able to. So thank you very much. I'd finally, in closing, and I'm going to ask you to excuse me, but I would like to pay tribute both to Alan Meal and to David Burrows. Alan remains for the moment, at least until, well, only until, sadly, the new year as a member of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, of which I, for reasons that I won't bore you with, find myself as president for the moment. And David Burrows has reaffirmed his commitment through the Conservative Friends of Cyprus and will, I am quite certain, remain every bit as active in the future as he has done in the past. So it's au revoir, but it's certainly not goodbye to two very dear friends of Cyprus, friends of yours, and irrespective of party politics, friends of ours. Thanks very much indeed. I mean no discourtesy to your government representative. We've had a conversation which was very useful next door, so I've heard what he's going to tell you. I know you'll find it interesting. Thank you.
Thank you, Sir Roger. I'd now like to ask the government spokesman to deliver his speech.
Honourable members of the Parliament, dear Chris, dear High Commissioner, dear friends, I would like to warmly thank you for the invitation to address today's event at the House of Commons. The proposal put forward by President Anastasiades was positively received by all participants, including the United Nations, including the UK government, including the European Union, with the sole exception of Turkey and the Turkish Cypriots. Despite the negative stance by the Turkish side, on July 6, and in the presence of the United Nations Secretary in General, President Anastasiadis elaborated in detail on issues pertaining to the abolition of intervention rights and of the system of guarantees, and the importance of replacing them with a new security architecture which will allow for the full withdrawal of occupation troops within an agreed framework. At the same time, a reliable system of monitoring the implementation of the solution was put forward and explained. In the consultation between the sides that followed, the Turkish Minister of Foreign Affairs seemed to suggest to the UN Secretary General that it was willing to show flexibility regarding the need for the abolition of the Treaty of Guarantees and the right of intervention. During the dinner of all participants with the UN Secretary General, Mr. Çavuşoğlu steadfastly refused to reveal the Turkish positions, repeatedly limiting himself to claiming that he was flexible and that his positions were well known to the UN Secretary General. Given Mr. Çavuşoğlu's refusal to specifically present the Turkish positions on the chapter of security and guarantees, Mr. Guterres took an initiative and suggested to all participants to issue a brief press statement which would include the general accepted positions on the chapter of security and guarantees, as well as some other chapters where it was considered possible to achieve convergences of opinion or approach. When the UN Secretary General expressly noted the position concerning the need to abolish the Treaty of Guarantees and of intervention rights, both President Anastasiadis and the Greek Foreign Minister asked if the provisions for the termination of intervention rights and the Treaty of Guarantees would apply on day one of the implementation of the solution. Mr. Çavuşoğlu unreservedly stated that Turkish position remained unchanged. That meant, as he explained in front of all participants, including the British Minister for Europe, the existing system of security and guarantees, as well as Turkish intervention rights in Cyprus, would remain with review clause in 15 years. On the issue of troops, the unwavering position of Turkey was that the number would be agreed upon would remain permanently in Cyprus. As a result, the UN Secretary General, in order to avoid an impending crisis, took full responsibility and stated that in light of these developments, it is clear that on the issue of terminating the Treaty of Guarantees and the intervention rights from day one of the implementations, his suggestions throughout were based on a misunderstanding of the positions of the Turkish side during consultations with Mr. Çavuşoğlu. Dear friends, we are beyond disappointed more than anybody else that Grants Montana wasn't successful. Regrettably, at the end of the day, it is our country that is divided for the last 43 years. It is our country that is under occupation. Let me underline that the unacceptable current status quo is simply not an option for us, neither for the Greek Cypriots nor for the Turkish Cypriots. The outcome in Grants Montana is not, under any circumstances whatsoever, a positive development. But I cannot overemphasize the fact that this is not the end of the road either. We will intensify our efforts so that those conditions are created which will allow us to be optimistic that the termination of the occupation and the reunification of our homeland are possible. We remain fully committed to negotiating within the UN Secretary General framework, which clearly states that the current system of guarantees must be terminated, that the intervention rights should be abolished, and that troops withdraw upon an agreed framework. At Grants Montana, to our deepest regret and despite our best efforts, Turkey appeared unwilling to work within the UN framework to this direction. Our goal remains unchanged, and we are fully committed to it, to have a truly independent, sovereign, reunified state, free of any dependencies on third countries. A modern state, fully in line with the EU law, which will create real prospects for peaceful coexistence among its citizens. Thank you very much.
I'd now like to ask some of our parliamentary friends to say a few words. I guess my first ask, is anyone time constrained and needs to... Baroness Massey? Okay, if you're time constrained, Baroness Massey, and then...
Good evening, everybody. This doesn't seem to work.
I don't think the microphones work, so...
Okay.
No.
Sorry about that, the microphones don't seem to work. It's a very great pleasure to be here this evening and to see so many people. I thought there were about 10 people here, and now I found a whole room full of people, which is very significant to us, I think, that you are so interested as we are in these issues. And I do thank your representative for speaking so eloquently about the issues that have been discussed. I've been to Cyprus only 3 times and was delighted and pleased to do that and to meet so many lovely people and people who are obviously going to go very far, whatever happens in the negotiations. I'm a member of the House of Lords and...
The microphones don't work.
And I will now pass on to whoever the next speaker is, and maybe you can hear them better.
Okay. Thank you, Baroness Massey. I'd now like to kind of open it to the vice chairs of the APPG. Theresa.
Thank you, Christos. Well, I think it's very sad that we're yet again meeting at a time when talks have ended without a solution being found. I know there was a lot of hope invested in this recent process. I know that huge amounts of work had gone into it. I think both on both sides and from the UN, and of course, as we've heard, there was a significant contribution from the Foreign Secretary and the Europe Minister from our administration here in the UK. So it is, you know, very welcome to hear from the government spokesman today that this isn't the end of the road, that there is a willingness to try to carry on. My own experience previously as Secretary of State for Northern Ireland makes me realise that these processes are never fast, and success generally comes with a determination to carry on and to keep talking, though I can understand, you know, the huge disappointment which will be felt. After all, these negotiations have been continuing on and off for around 4 decades now. But I welcome the commitment we've heard from Nikos this evening that the Cyprus government is determined to, you know, continue to work hard at this process. And I also welcome the fact that so many British Cypriots are here today to express their support for the efforts to bring unity back to the island of Cyprus. Many of you here have been supporting this cause for all of those 43 years. Many of you here have suffered greatly as a result of that invasion. And I want to pay tribute to the work that you have done over so many long years to try and bring justice and freedom for Cyprus. We haven't achieved that goal yet, but rest assured, I will continue to be with you every step of the way. This has been an important cause for me for 18 years, and if I have to work another 18 years to bring you that settlement you want, I will do that. Thank you for the support you gave me during the election.
Next, Joan Ryan.
Thank you, Christos. Good evening, everybody. Despite the palpable feeling of disappointment in the room at the failure of the conference, I am very pleased to be here with you this evening. The first thing I want to say is a huge thank you to the community for the support that you gave me, that I know you give to all friends of Cyprus during an election period. During that election period, I didn't know what the outcome would be in Enfield North. As many of you will know, we almost never know what the outcome will be in Enfield North, and we have won and lost. So the support that the community gives is very welcome to get you through that 6-7 weeks of really hard work without knowing whether you'll get over the line at the end of it. During the election campaign, I went to the Cyprus Wine Festival, which was at Pickett's Lock in Lee Valley. And it just reminded me that we do talk a lot about the Cyprus problem, and rightly so, but there is a huge community here, a vibrant community, a very active and engaged community, and big part of my responsibility and all members of Parliament here is to make sure we are aware of the needs of the community here and that we work to meet those needs. And I said when I was elected, I am going to be campaigning for the people of Enfield North, and that's as true for my Cypriot community as for any other. So I look forward to doing a lot more work over the next few years with the community. I know in Enfield both the Greek and Turkish Cypriot communities will be very disappointed at this outcome, that both communities in Enfield want there to be a way forward, would be hoping for that. And we've had more hope throughout these talks and over the last year than we've had for a long time since. And that's why it's doubly disappointing for it not to succeed. But I too heard the words, the very eloquent words of the government representative from Cyprus, that this is not the end of the road, and we must remember that, because the responsibility to ensure that everybody feels this is not the end of the road rests with all of us. I pay tribute to the work that you have done as a community, as a diaspora and expat community, and as a British community, striving for peace and fairness and justice. And that is a very difficult journey for anyone to take. But we know, wherever we've looked in the world, eventually, those things come to pass. People do not walk away from their birthright. They do not walk away from the need for self-determination. They do not walk away, at the end of the day, from the human rights concerns that they have. And I know that the community in Cyprus and the community here will never walk away. And therefore, we will never walk away. We will stand there with you until we get that outcome. And there's always some positives to take away from any talks that occur. We always have to hold on to those positives. I think there are positives we take away. There's been many firsts over this conference. And I think the fact that we all felt such hope demonstrates that there were many positive discussions and good takeaways. We just have to hold on to that. We have to continue to build constituencies for peace here and in Cyprus. That's the work that's in front of us. My commitment is to work hard for my communities here to make sure that you have the engagement you need with this Parliament and with your government. And my commitment to work hard for the thing that we all want to see, peace, justice, a viable settlement for Cyprus, for Cypriots, by Cypriots. And if this had been for Cypriots and by Cypriots, I too believe we may well have been sat here planning the celebration for a reunited Cyprus. As it is, my good news is I leave for Cyprus in less than 2 weeks' time. And despite the fact that I doubt it'll be quite the party atmosphere that I was hoping for, I still know there's always a very warm welcome in Cyprus, and I look forward to being there and being back with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joan. Our next speaker is someone who I think we as a community are proud of. Our first London MP of Cypriot origin, Bambos Haralambos.
It's wonderful to see so many familiar friends and faces here today. As many of you know, I've grown up in the community. The first demonstration I went on was when I was 8 years old. So I'm fully immersed with the issues of Cyprus and the long hopes and struggles that we've had over the years. And I think just to pick on what Joan was saying, we mustn't lose hope. I've only been an MP for 4 weeks now. I've asked the Prime Minister questions on Cyprus on two occasions already. That's what I want to do. I want to make sure that Cyprus is at the forefront, that we do challenge the government, we do put pressure to try and find a solution. There are going to be opportunities to raise things. There's the issues around the European Union and about the Brexit negotiations, about UK nationals living in Cyprus. We need to be wary of how that can be a way we can move discussions on. There's going to be issues around trade negotiations with Turkey. If Britain wants to trade with Turkey, what does that mean? What pressure can we put on the UK government to try and reach, to help put Cyprus at the fore of those negotiations? We can debate things here. We can debate this. This is a room for Westminster Hall debates. We need to debate things. We need to make sure that Cyprus is at the fore of people's minds and that we do raise it up the agenda. And I know that with all the friends here, that that's something that we all want to do and make sure we try and use what time we have here, what abilities we have here to put pressure to try and find a solution. It won't be easy. It hasn't been easy for a very long time. But we are getting closer. I think the talks in Switzerland were a good chance. Unfortunately, it didn't come the way we wanted to. But you know, we will speak up for Cyprus in this House, and we will try and put whatever pressure we can to find a solution. I'm with you all the way. I know friends here are as well, and I hope that you know we will do you proud. Thank you very much.
Here. I'm the MP for Wood Green, and of course everybody has Wood Green deep in their hearts in this room. Very good. I felt an enormous amount of excitement when I read about what was happening in Switzerland, and with all you now feeling a sense of disappointment, my heart is down, but we're down and not out, and I think that's what all of our speakers have said today. I want to say how excited I was on the evening of the 8th of June that Bambos Haralambos was elected to this parliament, and it was a fantastic occasion. Not that David Burrows was not an advocate for Cyprus, he was, but it was something special for the community to have that name. And it's just funny, isn't it? Because of course we've got another Bambos Haralambos here, and on my phone I always get a bit confused about which one's phoning me. But it's lovely to have somebody who really knows Cyprus, who speaks such wonderful Greek, and can give us little tips along the way. I'm very pleased this evening to be hosting this evening, and Natalie, my assistant, is laying out the food next door. And also to say, we must also just remember the work of Andy Love MP and Alan Meal. You'd be aware that Alan didn't return with us this time in the same way David Burrows didn't. There's swings and roundabouts in elections, but we must always remember their hard work, because these matters get passed from people to people and we just carry them. It's not about one individual, it's that we carry the peace and the vision of peace as we go. So we know that there are security issues, guarantees issues, troops issues, and we know that we're not there. But we also know that the hope that we have for the younger generation. And may I say how lovely it is to have a few youngsters here. I can see a few over there, clearly enthused by the recent election. And the commitment that we have from Emily Thornberry, who's our Shadow Foreign Secretary, who said she was going to come and address the APPG. The election intervened in the meantime, but her commitment is still there. So in the autumn, I would like us to arrange for one of our APPG meetings to invite her along and hear her views and that of Jeremy Corbyn. We know that we have still, as well, the European Union. We've not yet left the European Union. And it's very important that we still work together with friends there, the other 27 member states, to encourage, support and be friends. But in the end, it's going to be, as Joan said, by Cypriots, for the future. Just before I sit down, I just briefly wanted to say that there's a big piece of work to do here in the community, and that is for our older folk. And I want to put on record tonight a challenge for everybody that in a year's time, we've done some fundraising for the wonderful Cypriot Centre in Wood Green, which has not got very much funding, but that we support the work that Susie and all of the committee do there. Susie Constantinides, wave. There she is. You know, she's not 21 anymore, folks.
Yeah.
But she's doing a wonderful job. And every time I go in, there's people playing chess, there's meals on wheels, there's stuff happening. And we have to look after our community here. So a little challenge there to look after our older community here. Because our hearts are here as well, aren't they? They're not down there, they're here. And we have to continue that work. So please help us with that project. And finally, this parliament has to be the parliament where this MP visits Cyprus. So you're going in a couple of weeks' time. We know that you've been many a time, Bambos, and as have you, Teresa, and everybody else. I'm sure, Mike, you've been. But now that I'm released from the front bench, the shadow front bench, I can visit. And I'm looking forward very much to doing that, hopefully, in the autumn. So we're with you. Please let us know. We will ask parliamentary questions. We were in the Foreign Office questions where Bambos asked his question just this week. It's a fantastic place. This is your parliament. Get involved, particularly our youngsters. Be the future. And we look forward very much to carrying the peace and to bringing it in the end. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Thank you, Catherine.
Pleasure.
Mike Grimm.
In that, unusually, I'm gagged. Most of you who will know me, Finch and Golders Green, will know I'm not afraid to scream and shout and speak. But I was recently appointed to the Whip's office, and unlike other ministers, Whips are not allowed to speak in debates. We're not allowed to ask questions. We're not allowed to table questions. We are kind of there and just a silent menace in the chamber. So for once, you will not be hearing much from me after tonight. But that doesn't mean that my commitment to you is in any way undiminished. Because I wanted to tell you that whilst you might not be seeing me tabling questions or asking questions or speaking in debates, you can rest assured that ministers will be nobbled in the lobbies and in the corridors as they go past. The one thing about Whips is that we are not afraid at pinning ministers to the wall because they usually want something from us eventually. So Whips are normally quite good at saying, well, the quid pro quo is you'll sit and listen to my pleas on Cyprus. So I wanted to give you that assurance that whilst there'll be a period of quiet, you have not lost my support. And my job is to ensure that we continue to support the quest for a fair settlement and that we continue to support our friends in the Cypriot government, the only legitimate government in Cyprus. And that will be the point that we continue to press, that there is only one government in Cyprus and there is only one solution that we support. And we, despite the recent setbacks, we continue to press that. So whilst I might be quiet in some quarters, you can rest assured that the Foreign Office ministers will be getting a lot of earache from me in private. But my final thing is that over the time I've been a Member of Parliament and before as leader of Barnet Council, The friendship that the community has shown me has been very, very special and very much appreciated. And I just wanted to thank you for that friendship, and I wanted just to reiterate that your friendship is returned and that my friendship is not going away and is unwavering in the support for you, the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Mike is my local MP, so he hears a lot from me. So thank you very much for support. There were three members who came just before we started but had to leave, so I wanted to kind of thank them for their presence as well. Jack Dromey, the MP for Birmingham Erdington, Roger Godsiff, who has now taken up a role on the APPG, and Caroline Noakes, who is a parliamentary undersecretary. Yeah. So I'd like to thank those three for turning up. Unfortunately, they had to head out. Oh. I don't know. Who is it? I think. Sorry? Bob Stewart. Bob Stewart seems to have just arrived in time. Well, Bob, I was going to ask you to say a few words. Sorry to doorstep you for as the second you come.
Say a couple of words.
About why Cyprus is where your heart is, if that's where you want to.
Why Cyprus is important is because I was a boy there. And I was a boy there for 3 years. You cannot have a more beautiful country in the world. You cannot have a place where you can ski in the mountains and swim in the sea in one day, unless you're, of course, in Lebanon. You cannot have such a beautiful place where you have great wine, great beer, Kio, nice lemonade when you're a boy called Kian, history that absolutely reeks like Episcopi. That wonderful amphitheatre at Episcopi, which was destroyed half by an earthquake and took away, where you can drop a penny and you can hear it at the top. Or you cannot have Neolithic settlements where the people were buried and they're still there. You cannot have such a beautiful place. The politics is tragic. It's totally the reverse. I would really like to see Cyprus reunited. And I would really like to see this beautiful country fully available for anyone to travel in. And that includes the north to the south and the south to the north. As a boy, we had a hut between 6 and 6.5 mile beach to the east of Kyrenia. I played with a girl called Eva Papasavas and her brother. I loved those children. I think Cyprus has got everything. And I consider Cyprus to be a very special place that requires very special sorting out. Is that enough?
Yes. Take questions now. Mihaly.
What's the name of this gathering here? Just last question.
Ask questions.
For example, I want to know what is the panel's opinion of the guarantees. Turkey insists that there will be guarantees on Cyprus and also chose permanently. What is your position? I haven't heard anything from nobody. This is a crucial issue because, okay, the Greek side President Anastasiadis, there is a will of the Greek Cypriot side to find a solution. He made a lot of concessions. But the real obstacle is Turkey. And please, I want to know the opinion of the panel about these two crucial issues.
Who would like to tackle that first?
I think both sides have got to compromise. It's the only way ahead. I don't like the idea that Turkish troops are in Cyprus. I have to remind you that as a boy, my father was a soldier in Cyprus. And his men were shot at by Greek Cypriots. Be fully aware, it works both ways. And as a boy, travelling between Akrotiri to Nicosia, we didn't trust stopping at the Greek halfway house. We went to the Turkish halfway house. Believe us, you have got to compromise both ways. It is not just one way. And so you ask for my opinion. My opinion, sir, is you want to have peace in Cyprus. You want to have a good Cyprus. Everyone has got to compromise, not just the Greeks, but the Turks, in all senses, Greek, Turkish Cyprus, Turkish Cypriots, and Turkish... I'm sorry. That's, I'm losing my train of thought. You ask for an opinion, that's my opinion.
So, please, we ask for the members to give their answers. Let the other members answer. You ask the question, what's the position on troops and... Let's let the members answer. Jay.
I think it was the spokesperson,
Nikos,
who said it's anachronistic. I said for Cypriots by Cypriots. Although we are a guarantor power, I don't think it's for us to impose anything on anybody in Cyprus. And I think if we did do that, I wouldn't think it would last. And that's why it's not just a kind of saying a cliche, easy phrase. For Cypriots, by Cypriots, has to mean what it says. And what we just saw was Cypriots, the Republic of Cyprus, could not accept what Turkey was saying. And when they can't accept it, then this, for their good reasons, then this conference doesn't reach the conclusion we want. But that, as we said, is not the end of the road. I don't think we can sit here and say we will impose anything or otherwise. I think it is anachronistic. It clearly is, but how it comes to an end will have to be agreed at the level of face-to-face talks by Cypriots. We have to facilitate, we have to be honest brokers, we have to accept we have a responsibility in our relationship to Cyprus, but we have no right to impose. That would be my position. I'm not sure it gets us a lot further forward, but I'm not sure we'd be very much further forward if we did start laying down, you must do this, you must agree to that, you must do the other.
This is clearly a matter for the two sides to determine what they see as a settlement looking like. But in my view, I think that we should see an end to the principle of guarantees and an end to the right to intervene in the internal matters of Cyprus. I don't think that is appropriate in a modern day and age. I don't think that's what many Cypriots want. So I want to see them come to an end. I also, for many years, I've supported demilitarisation. I think, I hear what Bob says, that clearly there will be a need for compromise in terms of reaching a settlement. But I do think, it is far, far preferable. What I want to see is if there is any settlement includes a continuing presence for the Turkish military, that has got to be time limited. There's got the proposal for an indefinite presence by Turkish troops in Cyprus, I do not think is fair. I don't think it's justified by the circumstances. And so I very much hope a future agreement between the two sides contains those components.
And I think what we need to do is see this in stages. Over the summer, communities need to go back and talk to each other about why it didn't work and regain those conversations at community level so that next time, when people get together, there are these suggestions, there are these ways forward. Because in any peace process, it's not just the parties who are talking around the top table. It's after the talks, people go back to their communities and listen again and then come forward. But I don't think that we can necessarily solve everything tonight, except to say that we won't give up, because the worst thing to do is to give up and to feel that you're walking away. So right now, straight after Switzerland, is the time also for everybody to have a holiday. And I can say that as a no overall control government. It's quite a tough place to be. And I think a rest for a few weeks over the summer and then coming back together with these suggestions, with these new approaches. Because in any stage-by-stage negotiation, you have to take back what it is that you learnt at the last peace negotiation, so that you can have another go and you can get back round the table. And that's the important thing, that we play our role in making sure that our government continues to care. Because when you get that excited and hopeful, it's hard for the international community to stick with it. But that's part of our role, is to keep our government in there and caring and keep that hope alive. And I think that's what we're here for, to keep that hope alive.
I have the note of Transmontanahia. No participant in the conference on Cyprus, except Turkey and the Turkish Cypriots, claimed that the Treaty of Guarantees or the right of intervention can continue in 2017, including Britain, including the UN Secretary General. And we didn't have a successful outcome in Transmontana, but what was important for us, it was the first time since 1974 that we were in the same table with Turkey, either they like it or not, with the presence of the European Union, because Cyprus is a member of the European Union and will continue to be a member following a solution of the Cyprus problem. And nobody except Mr. Çavuşoğlu, mainly Mr. Çavuşoğlu, insisted that a normal state in 2017 can be guaranteed from a third country, or a third country should have a right of intervention. That was clear.
Bambo and then Mike.
Yeah, just in answer to Mihaly's question, that there's no way that a solution will be found if you have Turkey continuing to occupy Cyprus. There has to be a date when Turkish troops leave. We have to know. That cannot be a solution, Turkey permanently being in Cyprus. So I think that has to be one solution. And the guarantor issue, well, it is outdated. The guarantor thing was from the 1960s, if not before then. And we're way past that. And that I can't see how an invading country can be a guarantor as well. But that's an issue for negotiation. But those are my views.
Okay, I can only give you my personal opinion, but as Theresa and Bambus have said, the idea that a mature democracy like Cyprus needs other powers to hold their hand and look over their shoulder is out of date and needs to go. And if I had my way, there would be no Turkish troops in Cyprus at all.
People educated from 200 years now, and We lost our lives. We lost our happiness. Our lives went away. We lost our property. We changed our lives. Our people died, suffer now. What can we do? What can we do? We want to go back. We want our properties, our lands, our churches. We want our houses. We are friends, personally. I have 30 Cypriot friends. I have one girl, one lady now, friend in Turkish Cypriot. Our fathers were friends from the next village, and now we continue to be friends. As friends, we communicate very well, and she understands us, her husband. They understand that the Turks are thieves. They have stolen our properties. What our ancestors, our grandfathers were to leave us property. And now we are refugees. We have no land to build a house to our children. What can we do? We need to go back. We need to take our land back. And we need something that we forget. For 43 years, we don't have, we have lost anything, not our land, but the I'm so, what it has anything?
Oh, friends,
I am so moved because my Solimad, I'm so
excited.
And we go to Leftonico and we see our land, and now, especially every June, if we were there, my grandfather has hilles, hilles, or 1,000 acres of land. Do you know every year how we lose? Maybe five, but the question is,
okay.
Do you know? You have to understand, we suffer. We suffer a lot because we are refugees. And just imagine if you were in our position. What would you feel? Thank you.
So,
I'm also a representative of my occupied city, Akanfu is the name. Our church is 23. Our mosque, our staples, they threw out all the icons, all our civilization. We have to protect this civilization long time ago there. And now they sold it all over the world. Even the Evangelium was here and they played here at the, in cards, how to say, our Evangelium, our gospel. They played in cards. We have to protect also our civilization. With Turkish troops, our land is going to be really Muslim. It's time to stop this destroy.
Thank you. I'm conscious of time because we actually don't have this room booked beyond 8:30.
Sorry, just have to address what Bob said. It was a leading question. How many Turks are in here? It was a British question. I thought it was an attack on us as Brits of Cypriot origin. I'll tell you how many there are. There are 3/4 British foreign secretaries who have praised intercommunal relations here in the United Kingdom and in London. The relationship between Turkish Cypriots and British Cypriots are paradigmatic of good relationship. Greek Christians, Turkish Muslims. It's a continuous case. There have been so many talks, so many meetings of the communities. And it's the only community where you haven't had clashes. You have people who expressed vociferously their opinions, and then they were touted as friends. Go to Yasha Halim in Greek Lanes. There are Greeks working there, it's a Turkish Cypriot shop, you have Greek Cypriots shopping. So therefore, I'm afraid the in between the lines of your question, I take objection to, if I understood it correctly. Yeah.
No, my question wasn't that. My question was, what's happened to the Turks who had land in the south? That's what I mean by compromise.
We defend their right to take back their land.
Good.
As well.
Well, that's a good start.
Yeah. As well.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I say that
if they return to the Republic of Cyprus and stay for 6 months, they can get all their property back. We cannot go and stay for a day in occupied part of Cyprus. This is the difference.
Be quite clear. My view is that Turkey should get its troops out of Cyprus. But remember, please, remember, there are Turkish Cypriots who are frightened. Please remember that. And that's why I mean compromise. For goodness sake, it is not just one-sided. People are frightened, and that's what causes disputes.
Okay, I want to order. We have this room until 8:30. So I think on that note, where Bob has clarified what he was saying, let's move next door. Thank you very much.
Obviously, that is a very long time ago, but I want to say fantastic contribution has been made to life all over the country by the Cypriot community that came at that time, opened businesses, employed people, and played a huge part in our community, and still do. And I consider myself very honoured to know so many people that have done so much for our society over all those years. The issue of Cyprus is, of course, still not resolved. There has to be reunification. I'm sorry that the talks appear to have stalled yet again, but there cannot be forever the partition of the island. There has to be a coming together, there has to be a reunification, and I'm absolutely determined that for all of my political life I will continue with that position and continue campaigning for the reunification of Cyprus so that everyone can live once again on the island, wherever they wish to live on it. I think that has to be the basis of the whole policy. I also want to say, for those that have contributed so much to our political life, and that Vambos now being elected to Parliament means there is a Cypriot voice in Parliament, and I'm proud to call him one of my friends. I'm proud to call him a Member of Parliament from the Labour Party, and I know that he will be that voice for Cyprus in Parliament. But he cannot do it alone. The voice has to be outside, the voice has to be inside, and the voice has to be very, very determined. Because so many people have suffered in the past and continue to suffer the hurt of what happened during those terrible days in the 1970s, and it's up to us politically here to get it right. I see a number of colleagues around here who are MPs in North London. My good friend Catherine West. Hello, Catherine.
Kalispera.
Thank you for being here today. And representing Hornsey and Wood Green as my nearest political neighbour and a very good friend of mine. Thank you all very much for giving me a few moments tonight. And thank you for everything you do in the community, all the community events you put on, and that sense of unity you bring to people who are Turkish Cypriots or Greek Cypriots, because at the end of the day, it is about the unification of the island of Cyprus for both communities and both languages. Thank you all.
Everyone knows that Jeremy's been a great friend of Cyprus for many, many years. When I was young, I used to go on demonstrations, and Jeremy was always there when there was no publicity, speaking up for Cyprus, making sure that our voices were heard, and making sure that we had a voice in Parliament. And I know that Jeremy will continue to do that, and I'm proud to be part of the Labour Party, led by Jeremy, that will actually make things happen. It's a team effort, and we've got great friends of parliamentarians across the parties, but I know as a Labour Party that we can actually really make a difference now, and we need to work together to make things happen. So let's hope we do actually bring a united Cyprus about in this parliament with Labour support and with friends across the parties, and we can really make it happen. But I can't thank Jeremy enough for all the support he's shown over the years for Cyprus, and I'm very proud to be his friend. Yay.